You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. I am joined on this edition by a returning guest, a guest that I haven't had on since episode 99. And by my reckoning, this is going to be episode 287, something like that. So coming back onto the show, we're mainly going to be pushing their show coming up this weekend. But we'll be talking about all other manner of things. I haven't even said their name yet. I am joined by Che Monet. Welcome back.
Hello, thank you for having me. I mean, episode 99, going on to like 200 odd now, that's making me feel old. Like, where's my career going?
You feel old. I'm almost 300 episodes here. And I don't know how I've managed it. We've got quite a few things to catch up on. And we'll talk about your show coming up on Sunday the 21st. I'm panicking.
21st of July. Imagine it was wrong. I mean, if it helps, I've been tagged in a post quite a few times a day saying I'm coming out Sunday 21st of August. Get your tickets now. And I'm just like, I wish it was August because then I had an extra month to do all the prepping and planning. But
definitely July 21st. I've got it. I've got on the website. I've got the links all in front of me now. We've got it. We'll talk about that in a little bit. But talk about your career first a little bit. So October 2021 was the last time we had you on. A lot has happened, both good and bad, in that time. Injuries and title wins. So I don't know, where will we start? Well, we just talk about the cool things, which was your blossoming career at TNT.
Oh, yes. It's like, let's talk about all the good things and just leave the injuries in the past. Yes, I mean, TNT has been an absolute roller coaster ride. Came in a big match. So originally, actually, funny story, it was only supposed to be me and Visage one-on-one, and the winner was getting to wrestle Effy on the big GCW weekend. And then the original date that had been booked in, I couldn't do because I was double booked. And then the next day, Visage has knees like me. So Visage was getting checked up for knees. And then Jay Apter was basically like, okay, well, you can't do this date. You can't do this date. It's going to be a triple threat. Good luck. And I was just like, wait, what? So, yeah, that's what happened when I first came in. And then I accidentally actually, I mean, this is breaking kayfabe here, but I accidentally won that match. I was not supposed to win that match. And I just decided not to get up from the pin.
So it's incredible though, because I mean, in Scotland you're around about the Central Belt quite a lot for things like girders, ICW as well. You're very prominent in that. We'll speak a little bit more about that shortly. But TNT seems to be just where Che Monet has properly exploded as a character and in these big matches with the likes of Visage, Effy, who's very much a very big pioneer, I suppose, in LGBT+. Wrestling and that inclusivity. So what was it like actually getting in the ring with Effy, even though all the issues trying to get to the match itself, but what was it like getting in with Effy and Visage, of course?
So Effy was a big deal because I remember watching Effy before he'd even blossomed as Jesse Santana. For those who don't know, I used to formerly be known by that name. But before I'd even became Jesse Santana, I remember the first match I saw at Effy was Effy versus Bailey's fan, the one from NXT. I don't know the girl's name. I've completely slipped up. But basically, Izzy, so she was maybe 14, 15 years old. And here's Effy taking head scissors and ranas by this girl who now looks like she's blossomed into a professional wrestler. But I remember seeing this guy and being like, oh, this is a joke. Like, this is what we're doing? This is it. And then I remember when I first met Effy at TNT, it was just like almost like kind of like a weird father figure in a weird way. It's like father figure, but he's on like ounces and ounces of acid almost. He's just out there. He's unapologetically himself. And so kind of who you see in the ring is who you see backstage, if that makes sense. So like, he's very proud of who he is. He doesn't give a damn who has a problem right beside him. He could be getting ganged up by 10 people and he's still going to hold his own. That's kind of who Effy was. So getting in the ring with him was kind of like, okay, this, we're doing this. This is how it is. So I'm here. Not only is this my TNT debut, however, this is technically I'm debuting on GCW. However, this is the first TNT versus GCW weekend. So it was just thing after thing after thing after thing. And I was like, I'm the outsider here. I'm the least experienced here. Therefore, I feel like I had more of a task to kind of live up to. Therefore, I decided Effy and Visage have their own thing, their shtick, their gimmick. And I had my gimmick. My gimmick in that match was, you just can play all the shitty games that you want. I'm the wrestler here. I came here for a fight. That's what I came here for. I don't know what you came to. I came to make a point. And then that point was proven when all the good feedback from that match that night, when I read all like the reviews and the feedback and all the fans, and it just kept going up and up and up and up and up from there. And I don't know, it was just, you know that way, like, I still watch that match back. Visage still watches that match back. And every time we do, we have to communicate just to say how fucking good we are, like... That's just the way it was. So not only was I getting to finally meet Visage, I was also getting to meet Effy. So it was 2-for-1 combo.
Did you feel like it kind of really evolved you as a wrestler? Like you said, you came in with, they had their gimmicks and everything, and you came in as you're the wrestler in that kind of situation. And before, you may have been a little bit more, maybe a bit more playing up to the stereotype side of things. But did you find that that was the moment where you went, right, I can strike a balance between being a bit more of a stereotypical kind of gay character to and wrestler? And that was at the moment where you went, right, I found it. I found the balance here that I can hit.
My whole thing was, like, I never ever wanted to be that stereotype character that was suggestions that were given to me and made it as if, like, this is what I had to build around to be successful. And then the more I wrestled and the more I started to watch myself back, I was like, not to be big-headed here, I can wrestle. I could go out in plain black trunks and put on a wrestling match and you wouldn't have a clue about sexuality. But I'm not boring. I am not boring. Therefore, I will come out, I will make my glitz and glam entrance, I will do all this. When that bell rings, it's game time. And this is why I feel like I get opportunities against these bigger stars or these bigger men, shall we say, the way I'm getting tossed about, is because I kind of, I'm not in the best shape. I'm not the tallest person, I'm not the biggest person, but I kind of have this like never back down attitude. When it comes to real life and as a gimmick. So I kind of took my personal life of growing up tough and having to kind of defend myself really early on and grow up really fast to protect my sisters and my family and stuff. I kind of implemented that into my character because they always say, your character is yourself times 10. My character that I nailed was, yes, I'm out there, I'm a wee bit flamboyant, I'm out there, but they never actually see like the serious side, which is like, I grew up fighting, basically, so Che Monet is not only this flamboyant diva who is out there and stuff, he's also a badass. He came to fight, he came to kick ass, and potentially maybe a bit of a serial killer as well. We're still kind of identifying that. So, yeah, like, that's how it is.
So, from that point onwards for TNT, especially, you got a one-on-one match with Effy as well, but I think the big thing we've got to talk about is your with the cheeky little buggers themselves. I think they're maybe just before on their cusp of being the cheeky little buggers. First up, Alexis Falcon, and then defeating Charles Crowley for the TNT world title. I mean, we won't labor too much on how long that reign lasted, but still, live on pay-per-view, was this the second GCW TNT crossover?
It was, yeah.
So the first one, you won by accident. But the second time, you defeated Charles Crowley, who's a massive character in the UK scene now. And you defeated him. Liverpool became TNT World Champion for a time. What was that like? just that feeling, that moment, even if it was brief.
It was, I was kind of feeling delusional almost, like as if it wasn't happening to me. It was definitely like a huge, oh, you're, wait, I'm what? I'm winning? What? I think the first thing I'm going to take away from that is, even though it's TNT versus GCW weekend, we were the last match of the TNT versus GCW weekend. Two TNT guys, two UK guys, main eventing that big weekender payoff almost. And like you said, like I feel like the journey almost was such an experience, because we left off from Big Gay Brunch and we built this whole storyline around it where I wrestled Alexis Falcon, put her down. So it was kind of like, it was my opportunity to take, like that was my moment. And I think Big Gay Brunch definitely highlighted kind of what I was saying, my skills in the ring. It's not just about the personality and persona, you also have to be able to wrestle. And I definitely think that was the moment where they were like, he can go. So therefore, I feel like Jay Apter, the TNT promoter, kind of strapped a rocket on my back and fired off. And again, I had a point to prove. I was main event of that weekender against Charles Curley, who's one of the, if not the biggest star in the UK right now, potentially. I don't know, but to me, he is so eye-catching and so many people love him. And that was a big opportunity for me. And when I won the belt, as you can imagine, it's emotional. Like, that wasn't just a belt. That was a TNT world champion, where you can look back and look at the long history of people who have had it, but there's not a history of a gay person having it. And that was my moment. I was the first ever world champion that's been part of the LGBT, or first ever gay world champion, something like that. And third around the world. So not a lot of people get to say that. So to me, it was an emotional moment. I got to share it with Vizaj, and like, it just goes to show hard work pays off when you're doing well. I started off one GCW weekend versus Effy and Vizaj. Fast forward to a year later, I'll say this, it's never a race, it's a marathon. When you're ready, your time will come, and people need to understand that.
But you're right, a year. That's what it took. A year from you making that debut to a year becoming world champion. Unfortunately, Tate Mayfair's defeated you in about 5 minutes later. But still, that doesn't take away from the actual moment the record books showing that you were TNT world champion.
I'm coming for it. I'm not done with it. I'm just, again, waiting for my right time, and I'm coming for it.
So TNT, just the amount of opponents that you had in that year span, like, I mean, even I forgot about the Big Gay Brunch when I was going through my list here, but being the match with Ali Catch and Session Moth Martina as well, big characters while teaming with Crowley and Falcon. It's these are the names now that are on everyone's lips when you're talking about UK wrestling and you're all involved in that journey as well. Not on the flip side, because it's still all good. ICW, you were in a prominent role in ICW as well, mainly with Victory Inc. or generally it was Polo Promotions initially, led by Jackie Polo. So you're not only in that year doing all that in Liverpool, but you're still in a very high position in ICW. You've suffered from things like your knee injuries in the past. Was that a worry at all? Did that have that in your mind? You're working yourself almost to the bone. I'm noticing near weekly, every couple of weeks, you've got a fairly high profile match going on. How did your body, you feel like your body was holding up during that time?
It's always a worry. It's always a scare, because you don't know, like no one knows when an injury can happen again, especially when you're already re-injured, it's like a reoccurrence, so you don't know. But I always say, it's always when I have a big opportunity coming up that things tend to happen, or my knee starts to get sore, or I hurt another body part. It's always something that comes up when you've got the biggest opportunity of your life. I feel like last year was very much just like, I don't care how much pain I'm in. I refuse to miss out on these big opportunities. They're flying across the board. I'm wrestling constantly. This is my year. Like, I'm not letting anything stop me. Like, knee, if you want to fall about the place and fall out of my cap, you're going to have to do that to stop me. Like, I was ready to just put my full body in the line, because I always go by as well, you don't know when your last moment can be, especially in wrestling, because sometimes it has a short shelf life, sometimes it can have a long shelf life because things happen that you don't expect, like neck injuries and stuff that just instantly retire. But I was refusing, like, if I was going to have to retire at the age of 25, 26, then this was my year that I can be like, I've done it and I'm happy with it and I can leave that. And I always will remember that I've done all these things because there's so many history moments.
Yeah, absolutely. Again, looking through these matches, of course, a lot of the ICW ones were featured on the WWE Network and then, of course, on Triller, on Fight TV, however you want to call it. I think we probably just speak about it briefly because October 21 was when the Fight Club things were kind of just about, we're full swing as well. And we probably did speak about the novelty of being able to go on the WWE Network and search up Che Monet. Did that ever get old? Did it ever get a point where you're going, another week, another match on the WWE Network and get to see myself?
It's quite mad when you're going on the WWE Network to find yourself, especially because you normally go on and you'll be like, oh yeah, I'm going to watch WrestleMania, oh yeah, I'm going to watch Royal Rumble, but this was, I'm going on WWE's Network to find me, my name, I'm searching Che Monet in their search bar, and I'm appearing, my face is there, I'm front cover on ICW, so it was a big deal. Like, I think still nowadays, like, I will still classify this as an achievement. Like, if people ever ask me, like, name all your stuff, like, your qualifications, not qualifications, like, your, what's the word I'm looking for? Like, your
accomplishments.
Accomplishments. That's exactly the word. It's kind of like, I am still going to say WWE Network because whether I'm took down from that or not, I was on that at one point and a lot of people got to know me from that. So, but I wish I could show them this Che Monet, because I feel like I'm fully developed into a different person.
It was just a wild time that you could just do that. You could just go, oh, there we go. Oh, there's Che Monet in the thumbnail.
There's me with the hat back pose again.
It's just an incredible moment that you're able to do. Well, not just as a wrestler in general, but like we've mentioned, and we'll probably speak about it a little quite often because we've got the I'm Coming Out show to speak about. As someone who is openly gay and very, you don't get that character on the WWE Network at that time.
Oh.
Even the characters that were like your Darren Young, they were still fairly straight laced wrestlers. I don't think they even came out during their WWE run. So to see that must be very inspiring for a lot of people. I don't know if you got messages. People saying that they saw you and they've been inspired to do that.
There used to be like random people would put like tweets and stuff up being like another week of ICW on the WWE Network, Che Monet featured and stuff like that. So there'd be people like virtually like tuning into this just to watch me. But I've never heard of this person. I've never seen them like a local ICW showing that. And then it turns out like, say I click on them and it's like, oh, they're from Dubai, or they're from America, or they're from Canada. So it's crazy when you see people like that. And that's one of the things I miss about being on the network, is you would get people all over the world kind of tuning into what you're doing, but you're surprised by it because you're not expecting it. So I don't know, like, it's mad to say that it was ever a thing, I think.
I know. It's now on Triller. It's now on Fight TV as well. So it's still on a global scale through that. But yeah, just being able to say that you're as seen on WWE, get that on the poster and all that kind of thing.
Like you said, there was no one like me featured on the WWE who is out there. Yes, you had your Sonya Deville. Yes, you had your Darren Young. But like you said, they were very much just. You wouldn't tell unless someone had basically communicated it to you. But, I mean, I'm here to be different. I'm here to stand out. And hopefully one day, before I'm 30, WWE might be like, do you remember that boy from the WWE Network? Yes, the one in the leotard. Let's get him on the next tryout. And I'll be like, absolutely.
So speaking of ICW then, I think the most important thing, you went through the thing with the Polo Promotions and as it merged into Victory Incorporated, and you faced DCT, who has been well documented, a very close friend of yours through wrestling. I think it was this his final match that you were in with him, or was it one of his final matches?
I was at the final pay-per-view live match. So originally I was supposed to be this final match, but DCT very much wanted to hand over the torch. And that's what he did.
So that was probably Ryan Richards, was it, off the top of my head?
Yes, it was. Yeah. It was.
But for yourself then, for being able to be, like, well, passing the torch aside, that's kind of an epilogue. That's an add-on. Yeah. So I think I would confidently say that you had DCT's last proper match. I hope Ryan Richards isn't listening. He probably will think different. But must be an emotional night being able to wrestle someone who comes so close to through wrestling, and someone who no doubt has been. Oh, he was your first guest on your podcast, your brief podcast. So yeah, what was it like actually wrestling him for one of? Or I'm hearing Ryan Richards just kind of communicating through the ether that I'm wrong. But one of his last matches was like getting
his last match. His last match that counted. it was a big moment because I'm not one to, I'm quite hard shelled, so I'm hard to crack, like to make cry or anything like that. And I had kind of just accepted the fact, but it didn't actually hit me. It's kind of like one of those things where you know it's coming, but it's not hit. And then getting to obviously share the ring when we had been talking about for ages, we need to be on the same show wrestling each other, and we never ever got that moment. And then we got it twice in the space of 1 month, because we got to wrestle Target the week before, and then we went and wrestled each other on ICW. So it was kind of like, that's a taster of what you're going to get. This is the official. So yes, it was very much like a big moment, especially I think I managed to hold it together until Debbie Sharp and Denise decided to blummer in the most Denise way. Like, but she was physically crying. And then it kind of just got to this point where we were sharing a moment kind of downstairs afterwards, and I just kind of like shed like one tear kind of dripped. I was just like, I'm gonna miss you.
I love speaking to you for it, because you do have this such like extrovert character, but when speaking to you, you're quite introverted and like you're saying, quite hard shell to you. You don't give that much emotion away if you speak to the man behind Che Monet, but if you speak to Che Monet, he's a bit more theatrical. I suppose that's the way to put it.
Che Monet will cry in front of you, whereas like I'm just kind of like, I feel like they're kind of two opposite people. I'm quite like me, I'm quite laid back, I'm chilled, whereas like Che Monet is very much like in your face constantly and wanting attention. Che Monet's an attention whore. That's exactly what he is.
So brief couple of matches, then we'll get into I'm coming out, because I think that's the most important thing we're going to speak about. What, back to TNT briefly, I want to speak about the match had Ignition recently, just because I've seen the names in it and I need to know more. We'll speak about Target as well before we move on. Charlie Evans, Drew Parker, you're teaming with Emerson Jane. That's a pretty tasty tag team match, and hard-hitting and terrifying, I suppose, yes. With the three of them quite well in tune with deathmatch wrestling. I haven't seen highlights. I don't know anything more than just seeing the result of that match. Yes. Was it as bloodthirsty as I'm thinking it, imagining it in my mind?
I mean, it was Ignition show, so Ignition is the family show of TNT.
Ah, right, okay.
So essentially, we were like, okay, this has to be like family-friendly tag match. And then Emerson just, within the first 2 minutes, bursts her head home, and she's bleeding all down. And I'm just like, oh God, like, we were not prepared for this. And so she's literally bleeding. I'm kind of like trying to help her without getting blood on me. And it was just, you know, it was such an easy, fun match, and again, it's three big names that I get to share a ring with. It's one of the moments with the Effy and Visage thing where it's like, oh, here we go again. And it was so funny because me and Drew Parker have a great relationship, and that was my first time properly meeting Charlie Evans and Emerson. I know that bitch. I know her too well. So it was just kind of like, this is someone that I've known for years. This is someone who I've grown very close with recently. And this is someone who I'm brand new to. So having to get to share the ring with them, not only just share the ring, but the chemistry that all four of us had was pretty much solid throughout. So it was kind of like, I remember hearing a fan shouting from the crowd being like, why is this not in a main show? And it's not that Ignition's not a main show, it's the family show, but they want it like on the TNT big, the 18 plus shows, which immediately is just like, if someone's like requesting this on a bigger show because they know how much of a huge match it is, then I mean, TNT, do your business.
Is that of interest to you, like the death match wrestling? I know there's quite a discourse in wrestling recently about it because we've got like some Bleeding Gums now in Scotland as well. Is deathmatch wrestling something that interests you as a concept? Would you do it?
I'm not giving away spoilers.
Oh well, there we go.
That's what you're just going to need to stay tuned for the rest of this year.
There we go. So Target, we'll throw in Target as well because you defeated Robbie X for the High Octane Division Championship. Which, I mean, Robbie X, again, another big opponent, appeared on WOS Wrestling. Did he appear on Five Star? No, I don't think he did. But he was definitely on WOS, which is coming back this year. He's been around for a little bit. Target seemed to be just, they throw in some very big names, like your Johnny Storms and all that kind of stuff, who I think, are you wrestling this week? You're wrestling
this week? I am. Johnny Storms. This Saturday.
Saturday. So that's past. If anyone's listening to this, tickets are already gone and sold. The show's happened.
But I've probably been beat up, left in the ring. Sorry.
Yeah. But that's, again, big opponents that you're getting thrown in with. And it's what was it like? Your TNT title reign didn't last long, unfortunately, but still historic. But yes. Your High Octane Division title reign is still ongoing as we're recording, and I'm sure it will still be going when this episode goes out.
Hopefully.
Did you find that one a bit more satisfying because you knew you were holding it for at least longer than 10 minutes?
I didn't know I was winning it until the day.
Nobody tells you anything.
I didn't know. Like, no, generally, like, I went, what do you mean? Like, I'm confused. And then, because Robbie, as far as I'm aware, just won that title. So I was expecting, okay, I'll get a cool match at least. Like, I'll get a fun match with Robbie. I've never worked him before. And then they were like, oh, yeah, you're winning. And I was just like, wrong person, wrong match. I don't know what you're talking about. And then it turns out, like, it was just, oh, I forgot to tell you. Okay, clearly. And then, like, it just keeps getting better and better. Like, Robbie was phenomenal to work with. Like, the man is just wrestling rings around me. Like, he's so fast, yet so agile, yet so, like, how do I put it? It's like, I don't know where he is. I'm still making my entrance to this man. It's done a 30-minute match before I'd even get in the ring. Like, that's the way I'm putting it. Because what an incredible match. And, like, I wish, like, more people could have seen it. Because if you have the opportunity, it's on Target's YouTube page. Please go have a watch. To me, that's like a ICW Progress TNT over 18 show style of match. And that's not me saying it shouldn't have been in Target. I'm thankful it happened in Target, and I'm hoping more people go watch that, because that match was kind of like something where, if you've seen like NXT crowds recently, where they're just indie and they're loving everything, that was, if that doesn't prove I can wrestle, then I don't know what else. I really don't know what else.
I remember watching Robbie X during the Clash at the Castle weekend, his match against Kenny Williams, mm-hmm. kicked off after hours, and I was like, oh my god, why is Robbie X just like popping up occasionally in Scotland when he should be just getting grabbed and thrown everywhere?
Exactly. I generally didn't know he was still wrestling until the match got announced, and I was just like, this man needs to be seen more places. Like, yes, he probably is traveling internationally, but it's like, I want to see more of him, and I want more of him in the ring. Like, I want to be sharing that ring with him, because I feel like this is a problem. This is kind of jumping onto a new topic, but it's like, I know a lot of people look at me and go, he can share the ring with Robbie X or Leon Slater. or I'm trying to think.
Ray Horace.
Like, people don't look at me and think they can do that. And LJ Cleary, I'm wrestling on TNT at the end of this month. So it's like, people don't look at me and think he could wrestle these people. And then TNT and Target give me these opportunities to go and wrestle these people. And people go, holy shit, we were not expecting that. And it's like, because you don't give me the opportunity.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that kind of thing just drives you? Maybe not a chip on your shoulder, but do you always kind of have that drive going, every match you've got to prove somebody, some hypothetical person wrong, to prove why you're doing this?
Yeah, people ask me all the time, like, oh, why do you do this on this show? Like, it's just a wee show and all that. I don't care how many, I don't care if it's 5 people in the audience, I don't care if it's 500 people in the audience. I'm going to give them something to remember me. And again, I will wrestle every match like it's my last match, because you don't know, or like, you don't know who's watching. That's the thing. Like, people get snatched up literally thin air, like Leon Slater to TNA or Joe Henry to TNA and stuff like that. Like, I know Joe Henry had previous stuff going on with TNA, but like, he's came back, and look at him now. Like, he's completely developed into something different. So it's like, you don't know who is watching or who's scouting you or who's just all of a sudden in that audience at that moment. So yeah, like, that does add drive to do better, to be like, I need to prove myself against these people, but I need to prove myself, I need to be happy with myself in that ring for me to walk backstage after that match and be happy. If I'm not happy, there's a problem, and it's normally never anyone else's fault. It's normally me as a wrestler, you're your own worst enemy, and I'm sure any wrestler can vouch for that.
So, speaking of proving yourself, then let's talk about I'm Coming Oot. So was it said returns when I got the One Fall Media press release? So I'm gathering then that did you have a bit of a hand in the Iron Grinder show they did, or have you? I'm trying to remember if you did a first I'm Coming Oot kind of show. When was that?
So I didn't do the first ever I'm Coming Oot. I done Iron Grinders,
right,
which was last year. And Iron Girders. So this was a partnership that I'd worked with Iron Girders with, which was a success. And that's why I decided to bring back an even bigger and better show this year. But I wanted to feel control of it. I wanted to be like, this is what I've created, so that if it goes massively amazing, fantastic, that was all on me. If it goes terrible, it was on BT Gunn.
So again, yeah, it's that kind of not bitterness, but it's that kind of just hard nose proving yourself. You're like, okay, cool, we had a great time in the partnership, but I want to make sure that I can do it myself, kind of thing as well.
Exactly what it is. It's like, if this is going to fail, it's going to fail on me. If this is going to success, then it's going to succeed on me. So it's like a risk. You never know if it's going to pay off until you do it. So this is a risk that I'm taking, and if it pays off, maybe you'll see I'm Coming Oot part 2. If not, then I guess I'm like, okay, well, I'll just go back to the old wrestling then. That's what it is.
So it's of course called I'm Coming Oot Saturday. Oh damn it, now I've done it.
I wish it was a Saturday.
Sunday, the 21st of July, it's happening. 14 plus show, so folk can 14 plus with an adult, you can go to this. Yes. The event, VIP entry 6:30 PM, doors open 7 PM, first bell 7:30, tickets only tenner, ringsideworld.co.uk. So you thought the name I'm Coming Oot, it's your first solo promoted event that you've put on. Are you the type of person that's already got a list, if it goes well, that's already got a list of follow-up sequel names, sequel show names, or have you just taken it one at a time?
I think we kind of jot about. So look, Cairo is actually very creative when it comes to things like this. So he's always just sitting, like, I'll ask him for one name and he'll give me 20, and then he'll make an Excel spreadsheet with all these names on it. That's the type of person he is. But I think I'm Coming Oot was very much just like it's a perfect name, because I'm Coming Oot is obviously like a very popular Diana Ross song. It is also I'm Coming Oot, as in like I'm coming out of the closet, which I guess is like a gay reference, an LGBT reference, or when people come out as their sexuality. And it's kind of like I'm coming out as in like I'm coming out as Che Monet's first show. So I think the name is very fitting because I'm coming out of many different things. And it's actually Oot because it's a Scottish term, but I'm sure they worked that out.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know what it is with my accent, but when I say Oot, I just sound more Canadian than anything else. I don't know how that is possible as a.
That's weird. I'm coming out. You need to say it in a sentence, and it sounds better. Like, oh, today I'm coming out. It sounds better than just saying it. Rather than just like I'm coming out.
I know. You sound like a parody, like Willie the groundskeeper. So looking at the card, you've had for your first solo show. You've had the woes already of trying to structure a card, and things happen, and injuries happen, and things didn't happen, and having to rechange and add people and all that kind of stuff. So I'm assuming that was fun for you.
It was late. I got to tell people to piss off.
So we'll look at the card itself then. So we've got just absolutely stacked. A lot of names that I've heard of but not seen wrestle, so I'm probably going to be a little bit more of a backseat when you're talking about how amazing these people are. I assume that you're right.
I hate everyone on the show. What are you talking about?
Yeah, the main event's the one you want to see. So the VIP match, the Queer Crown Rumble qualifier, Fatal 4-Way. I assume it's still a 4-Way. I know that there's Zachary Swift is lingering about and on this show. But we've got Drew Mercury, Tommy Lockhart, Robbie Cardwell, and Jack Ripley. 3 out of 4 I've had on this podcast. So, Tommy, I'm going to be pestering you soon. I've had Drew on. Drew is very much open about his sexuality as well, part of the LGBT plus community. Robbie Cardwell, I've seen him evolve into this Jeff Hardy-esque creation. And Jack Ripley, you know, he's pretty risky, to be honest.
Pretty risky.
So these four will compete to compete in the Wrestler Queer Crown Rumble. Easy for me to say. Later on in the evening. But when you're putting these four together, how do you structure them? How do you put together these kind of matches? Someone who's been wrestling on shows, then now you're got these bunch of names and you're trying to throw them onto this card and make the best matches possible. What was your kind of process for this one?
My process for this one was basically, I feel like there's many people that don't get seen as much that deserve to be seen. So I'm all about giving opportunity. I don't care how pally you are with me. I don't care how much you kiss my arse and all that. If you're working hard and other people believe you're working hard, then it will be noticed. So I'm not just going from, oh, Che Monet likes this person, so I'm putting them on. I will contact people like your Wolfgangs and your BT Guns and your Jack Jesters and ask, do you think this person deserves a spot? And these are names that have been put forward to me. Well, I know some personally, so that's why I've decided this person is good, this person deserves a spot. This is why I put them in. So, for example, Drew Mercury does a lot for me. He's very much evolving himself. Without giving any spoilers, there's a lot of change coming about him that you'll notice soon. But he can do a lot of things that not a lot of people can do. Mixed in with Jack Ripley, who is your favourite porn star. So it's right away, two different, you have your Lucha Libre type wrestler, and then you have your porn star character wrestler. So it's right away, two different dynamics of people. And then you have Tommy Lockhart, who obviously was a wrestler who came back and is doing like his great showman. And then you have Robbie Cardwell, who is just, he's just there for Jeff Hardy cosplays, just so the audience knows who that is. That's actually Jeff Hardy. That's not Robbie Cardwell.
I don't think he'd get in the country. I didn't realize Tommy Lockhart was Tommy Marks. Until I recently spoke to Luke and Sharp for a podcast. He just said it just in a sentence. And I was like, holy shit. I didn't realize
it's the same person.
He just looks so different. Like, he's just so ripped. And he's got the cracked mustache. And
mustache.
I can't pull that off.
I was speaking to Drew earlier, and it's so funny because he was like, oh yeah, like Tommy, like the kind of least experienced guy in this match. And I just went, no. He used to wrestle ages ago, what are you talking about? And he went, did he? And I was like, yes, he's been a bit for ages. And I was like, he's been here like more than me, technically. And then Drew was like, oh, well, I'll go fuck myself in.
I know, as soon as Lou said it, I looked at him and went, of course it's Tommy Marks. I recognize that. I recognize the eyes. It's the eyes, yeah. You recognize. And I think I saw him wrestle. I think he teamed with Kaylee Ray, maybe. But this was a long time ago.
Back in the day.
2014, I think it was. 2014, 2015. So a while ago, I didn't have hair there either. but it was a long time ago. But yeah, to see him come back and absolutely change himself as well. And this is almost his coming out as well, because he's kind of been plying his trade at Iron Girders.
He's been in the closet for so long.
He's been hiding at Iron Girders with his top hat and tails. So yeah, it's a very much a big mesh of types of characters and wrestling. So that's often the best way, isn't it? You don't want two wrestlers that have got the same style. That generally kind of cancels each other out.
My thinking going into it was, let's start the show off with four gentlemen who are desperate to prove themselves, who are desperate to keep, again, with that kind of TNT skyrocket thing. These are four people who are hungry and want to do the best they can with a successful career. Why not give them a shot? They're here for it.
So that's worth getting the VIP ticket or the getting there early. Just for that. I haven't even said where it is taking place. It's taking place at Slay in Glasgow. As I don't know anything about Slay. I can make assumptions about it, but I don't know. So is Slay quite a hot club area? How old did I sound in that moment? Is it a hot spot?
Is it a hot spot? Slay is more of a gig venue. So they normally host a lot of like drag bingo events and stuff like that. So this time, that's what I wanted to say around. Girders is great, and Girders is a great facility for Iron Girders to do their shows. However, I want the gayest spot in Glasgow City Centre, which is Merchant City. So if I'm going to do a pride show, you bet your damn boots I am putting it right in the middle of Gay Town, where nobody can touch me.
fair enough. So we've got six person tag. I'm so used to saying man. How sexist am I? We've got Daisy Jenkins and Act Two taking on Casey and the Young Team. Act Two is a team that I've names I've seen just be bounced around everywhere at the moment. Daisy Jenkins, one of my absolute favourites right now. She's just phenomenal. One of those that kind of maybe have the same mentality as yourself, because she started a little bit later. In a case of she's not here for a long time, so she's going to just do as much as she can in that moment.
Yeah.
We've got the Mother of Chaos, of course, the conscience of Scottish women's wrestling, certainly, Casey. And we mentioned the Young Team as well, Logan Smith and Jimmy Pierce. So, again, this is just... We can say this about every match on this. It's a nice meshing of styles and difference and all like that kind of thing. But was Act Two a team that you've had your eye on for a while for getting onto a show and seeing them?
So Act Two wrestled in Iron Grinders last year. They wrestled Arcade Violence and put on such a performance with Arcade Violence where it was like, I don't have a choice. I have to bring yous back. Because you've done such a good job in the first one, where it was kind of like, it's like kind of like a reality TV show. You impressed me, you're coming back. And there was a bunch of people who came up and done Iron Grinders from down south. And Act Two stood out like a sore thumb, to the point where people were saying to me, you have to bring them back. I have no choice but to bring them back. I'm a man of the people. They got what they wanted. I got what I wanted. Act Two are coming back.
Yeah. I mean, nothing I really add to that. But yeah, so it's again, like I said, a team that have just been about everywhere. Young Team, mm-hmm. very, very active in the Central Belt as well. Casey is one of those ones that seems to be, you forget about Casey, and you shouldn't, but you kind of forget about Casey, and then you see her wrestle and you go, I don't know why I forgot about Casey for a moment, because she's just incredible.
She's great. She's so committed to her look and her character and stuff. Like, I've watched her paint her face constantly. I watched her paint her face like she'll wash it off and then she'll redo it, and it's commitment, because some people go, ah, no, I can't be bored. She's so attention to detail with her look, her character. If she's going to be the Mother of Chaos, she's going to let you know that she's the Mother of Chaos the second she walks through that curtain. And like the young team with Casey, like it's a unknown pairing. Like what are we going to expect from it? Because they're completely different sides of the spectrum.
Yeah, you've got the terrifying golf in Casey, and yeah, then the two wee Neds with her as well. It's
literally. Some she's going to murder them.
Next up, we've got Landon Riley versus Austin Brooks. Austin Brooks again, another very open wrestler for many years. We spoke to him on the podcast before. Landon Riley, probably one of the most exciting prospects I've seen come out of GPWA recently, and girders as well. He's popped up in there with some amazing acrobatic skills and what have you. Is Austin Brooks someone that's you've mentored or has come to you to discuss his kind of place in wrestling as well, I suppose, because as someone who has been open about their sexuality, and Austin Brooks, who did the same not long after publicly, is he a guy that you kind of want to mentor and maybe try and guide if you possibly could?
Yes, so Austin Brooks has asked me a lot of stuff. In fact, a lot of them do, which is very thankful, because I feel like I'm almost like 99-year-old veteran getting asked all these kind of big questions, and I'm like, you're making me feel old, like, don't. But Austin Brooks does come to me with a lot of opinions, and you can tell he listens to the feedback and takes on it. He just has that something missing that I just want to kind of throw him and catch and take it. Like, I kind of want to, like, you know, in video games when they pick up like health potions, like that's what I want to do, is kind of throw a health potion at him, because he's got everything. There's just one thing that he's missing that just needs to take him to the next level. And I'm hoping soon, again, no spoilers, I'm hoping soon that you will see that and people will pay attention to Austin Brooks, so that basically, like, I'm looking at it as, and like people always say, like, try and crosses over, like, oh, you're just similar gimmicks and all that kind of stuff. No, we are not. Watch us wrestle with each other, and it's two different people. Yes, we both like the same gender, but Austin Brooks is very like scheme mum. That is his banner. Like, he is a scheme mum, whereas I'm very sensual, I'm very sexy. I bring the element of I came to fight. Like, that's my thing. It's like, I am dominatrix and he is scheme more. We're nothing alike. So just because we are both gay and maybe have like kind of same similar banter doesn't mean we're the same wrestler.
Is he a guy who is asking you questions, has opinions? Is he a kind of person that would come to you? I know you did a post, a camera, it could have been 5 years ago, it could have been 5 months ago. My timeline is just absolutely broken because of the pandemic. About promoters, what only booking you to tick a box kind of thing. Is he a guy that would go, what's this promoter like? Are they acting in the best interest for myself, or are they just looking to fill a gap that they need to tick for a show? I mean,
without kind of making it as if I'm doing everything for queer people, like True Grit Wrestling had put on a six-man match, and the promoter was basically like wondering who he can book, and I said, I'm going to bring Austin Brooks with me, you're going to put him on the show. And he was like, oh, for the six man, absolutely. He's like, oh, he looks like a face, I'm looking for a heel, let him be a heel and you'll see. Like, stop. Just is that, that's nothing against promoter, by the way, James Carr is a very great man, that was not me digging at him. It's more so like, just don't judge by what you're seeing. Let that person show you what they're worth. If you like it, good. If you don't like it, that's fine. You don't have to use them again. But let him prove himself. I'm just here to give him the opportunity. I got him the opportunity. Let him blossom.
Fair. And Landon Riley, like I say, he's had some.
He has enough attention. We don't need to give him any more attention. No. He gets him.
Cool. That's fine.
But the reason for that match actually is quite short and sweet. They both wrestled one time during training in a match. They both wrestled one time and they immediately earned them both of them earned a booking right there in that spot.
So is this, yeah, it pays to go all out, maybe not all out, maybe go 90%, out in training matches because you don't know who's watching.
They gave 100. They gave 100. I was sitting there in the position. I looked about in the room and I went, are you watching us? Because this is a match. This is what y'all want in my show. And there you go. I wasn't there scouting, as in, like, I sat down with my shades on, my fur coat, like, go wrestle. I was there undercover as a wrestling trainee. And there you go.
Next on my list here, I've got BT Gunn versus Luke Cairo. For someone that helped you give you names for the show, why did you subject him to BT Gunn chops? That seems oddly cruel.
The man is crazy. Luke Cairo has a theme park going on in his head where you don't know where the next ride is taking you to. But at the end of the day, he's smart. He knows that BT Gunn is one of the best in the country. He wanted him. I gave it to him because Luke Cairo, again, is someone that I'm just feeling like, you're underrated. You've been wrestling longer than me. When are we going to give you the rocket to strap on your back and shoot up? Because you're talented. Show them. Stop sitting there doing nothing. You come out and show them. So that's why, like, Luke Cairo right away. Here's BT Gunn for you. Go make magic.
Has BT Gunn been... He seems to be someone that's kind of intrinsic with your career as well. You've wrestled quite often, or you always seem to be. His name seems to appear when shows you're on as well. Is BT Gunn just an important figure for your wrestling career in general? Have you been able to pick his brain a bit and help you improve?
Feel like I'm getting outed here. Do I have a crush on BT Gunn that I don't know about?
Is it the tattoos? No.
I need some explaining to Casey. I think it's just, you know what, like, the man helped me, and he was the one who proved to me that I can wrestle even without a gimmick or with a gimmick. He was the one saying, go and wrestle then. Like, stop trying to please other people. Go do what you want to do. Make yourself happy. Go have fun. And it's almost developed. He's kind of like the DCT relationship where we had, where it's kind of just... We started here, he was my coach, became more, sounds so wrong.
You're digging a hole here.
No, I just outed it, I'm sorry. It's more so just like, he's one where I know for a fact, if I was having my worst moments ever, he's just a call away. Kind of thing. Like, that's the type of person BT Gunn is. But I mean, we can't deny the man can wrestle, so why would I not put him on the show when he's one of the best goddamn wrestlers we've ever seen? Till stop.
He's kind of like that kind of father figure to you then. He's your daddy. You know what, I didn't think I could say it, but I was going don't say Daddy Gunn, but you
daddy
know
Gunn.
I think Billy Gunn might have an issue with that, but okay, I don't think he'll be listening. It'll be fine. He might. Who knows? Billy Gunn, if you're out there. a big match for Luke. And not so much like the connotations for I'm Coming Oot is because it's so multi-layered. But for someone like Luke Cairo, his coming out party will be hopefully surviving BT Gunn and proving why he should be on that show.
Yes.
You've wrestled BT Gunn a few times. How are the chops? Just out of curiosity.
I don't like him chop me. I don't think he has yet, but that's probably because they know I'll walk out the way.
Fair enough. The old Hulk Hogan, I know that's probably not a name to use, but I use the old, that doesn't work for me, brother. No, I'll
pull his hair, that's why, and he's no hair, so that's the joke, is I'll find a way to pull his hair.
We've got Visage versus Colton Davis as well, which is, again, a very interesting contrast in wrestler, because Colton Davis, the big straight-laced, tall, 6 foot, I don't know, a million, I can't remember how old he is, I don't need to know that, how tall he is, and Visage, who's this very extravagant, extroverted character. Is this one you have in your mind that you think, yeah, this is going to work? Kind of thing.
This was the first match that I booked. Visage, again, Visage stepped away from wrestling, came back to wrestling, stepped away. I don't know how many times that bitch was retired. She can let me know that. But it's getting to the point now where she is back for good. And I want to bring it up to Scotland. I want people to see Visage. So I went, who better to put Visage against than that 6'7" lanky ginger boy? And do you know what? Like, it just it was an automatic pairing of, like you said, you have this kind of straight, serious, big guy, and then you have the opposite. But the thing is, Visage is not small. So therefore, Colton is in for a challenge, because don't let that makeup and wig fool you. Visage is a fucking beast when it comes to the ring. So I better see Colton come back leaking of ginger tears when this happens. But honestly, like, it was just straight away like a match. It was a pair that I just went, I want to see this match. I'm putting this match on the show. Go, I'll say it again, go do magic.
And before we talk about your match, because this is the one, because your match is the one that had probably the headaches constantly before the show even begins. We'll talk about the wrestler queer. I just keep saying wrestler because it says 10 wrestler queer Crown Rumble on my notes here.
10 but, wrestler queer Crown Rumble. I can't even say it. Queer Crown Rumble.
It's going to be at least 11 because we've got Joe Blazer added at the last minute. And then we've got whoever wins the four-way.
Unfortunately, actually, I should have put that out. Rosie Knight will not be in attendance at the show. So it's still 10 people.
Still 10. Okay.
Joe Blazer is happily taking that spot. So there will still be 10 people. But you never know what can happen.
So the entrance, we've got Martin McAllister. Love Martin. Patience of a saint, that man. Lewis Gervin. Danny Kaye, who you've teamed with recently. Fraser Gervin. Love the Gervins. Denise, who's just mad.
Bonkers.
I don't know how anyone can keep a straight face around Denise when she's in full Denise action.
Whoa, and flow. That's all I hear when I see her.
Is that just from your mouth when you go, from her? We've got Dylan Thorne, Brody Turnbull, and Jake Lawless of Arcade Violence. Again, talking about a big mix. What is the queer crown? Is it a physical crown, or is there a title? What are they fighting for?
So the queer crown, basically. So those that don't know, Glasgow Pride is in July, so that's Pride weekend. So the queer crown idea was basically, this is a crown to sign off the weekend of who deserves it. Particular, so it doesn't matter. You don't have to be gay to win it. You don't have to be a lesbian to win it. It's not an LGBT crown. It can be won by allies. The main thing is, this is a pride show, and I wanted to give a crown away. So therefore, it's kind of like a beauty pageant. You know, when someone wins that sash and crown, and it can just claim it. This is basically the idea that I had, where I wanted it to not just be a rumble. I wanted it to be such a gay rumble. And what better way to make it gay than by giving them a sash and crown to win, like, as if they've just won a drag race. Like, that's what I'm thinking. Like, congratulations, you put 9 other people at a rumble. You just won RuPaul's Drag Race.
I'm just looking at the names here. Just the visual of seeing Dylan Thorne in a sash and crown is possibly worth £10 alone. Or, you know, I think Brody Turnbull could kind of pull it off. And so, you know what? So could Jake Lawless. I think there's a flamboyance under the graphics.
We can get Jake Lawless a sash for his baseball bat as well.
But Joe Blazer. So Joe Blazer is a name that, again, is one that's popped up on the old Twitter as a name that's recently. And I don't know a lot about Joe Blazer other than he's very charismatic.
Yes.
Is this someone who you've come across in your travels down south and across the border into that country?
Joe Blazer... used to be, I just call him Blazer. So Joe Blazer used to be known as Big Guns Joe.
Okay, right.
Joe Blazer understood the assignment. And he was like, there's big people out here. Like, there's people with muscles here. Like, it's easy to become a muscly, smaller guy. He went, I'm coming back and reestablishing myself. And he completely done that. And immediately it struck everybody's attention. So therefore, if you're big enough for me to stop and go and look at what you're doing, you're earning yourself a spot. Like, it's not about who I'm friends with or who I spend time with. Yes, I spend time with Joe when I'm down south. When I see him, it's good to catch up with him. However, if I didn't know Joe and I came across that promo, it's just charisma reeks out of him. Mm-hmm. And again, it's a person that we've not really saw in Scotland as much. So I want to give him that opportunity to be seen.
He's kind of got that, just from that promo alone, he gave me that kind of, I don't know if you'll take it as a compliment, but that kind of Lexus King kind of overconfidence, kind of charisma in there. Maybe it was a sparkly jacket that did it.
He reminds me of White Goodman from Dodgeball. That's who he reminds me of. And I love it. Like, do you know what? The first thing I saw when I saw his promo, I was like, gay. But like, in a good way, because I absolutely loved it. And I feel like Joe is just like, again, we have like your Dylan Thorne and your Lewis Garvin and like your serious wrestlers. And then you have Joe Blazer, the complete opposite. You have Denise, complete opposite. So it's how are all these people going to gel together? That's what excites me.
Yeah, I mean, especially like Lewis Garvin, we know what he does in Rumbles. So everyone's going to probably wear a cup that day, even Denise. Denise has had so many close calls in Rumbles. Wardrobe. Exactly. Yeah. Sorry, disclaimer, you may see nipple. It might not just be Shays. But yeah, she's got a interesting history of Rumbles, mostly for people going, oh my god, it's okay, everything is still in place. But she's still a very accomplished wrestler, former champion, former FCW women's champion as well. So don't let the Denise exterior fool you.
I am wrestling Denise in the next ICW show on August 4th, I believe it is.
Is that taps off or heavy roasting?
Heavy roasting.
I'm loving ICW bringing back show names. It's just a nice wee throwback to Fight Club days.
It's just a wee bit exciting.
Yeah. Martin McAllister, love Martin. Like I say, patience of a saint, that man. Because
he's got such an underdog energy. That's what I love about him. He's such an underdog that you cannot hate him. Mm-hmm. You have to love him. That's just kind of what Martin is.
I mean, we did a brief show with him after he won the Iron Girders Championship, which he would be the holder of. So I don't know if that will play a factor in this show. But yeah, it went all wrong. All our technology just died, and he was just still happy. He was so pleasant. He was so nice, and I was like, Martin, I think he's gained a fan for life just from that alone, because he's so wholesome. To watch wrestling.
He really is.
Until he comes up to Keith Ness, he seems to be a bit of an arsehole up here. But I don't know why. But well, maybe it's the altitude.
He's a vegan.
Funnily enough, I've had two chats with him. He never told me. I thought, I respect you for that. an absolutely packed queer Crown Rumble. And then, of course, whoever wins the qualifier will go in there as well. Let's talk about your match then. The one that, like I say, probably provided the most headaches for you. Because initially, it was Che Monet and Angel Hayes against a team of Alexis Falcon and Charles Crowley. Alexis Falcon got injured, so it became Charles Crowley and Liam Slater. Crowley went to Japan, or he's otherwise engaged.
Yes.
And then you brought an alley catch.
I did.
I mean, I don't want to toot my own horn here, but when I saw she had a date spare, I immediately tagged you in it. And I don't know if that helped at all, or made you aware that alley catch was available.
Me and alley catch are friends, so I know what she's up to. And we had been plotting for a while now. But the reason was, like, my show was fully booked at the time, so I didn't know where to put Ali Catch, because she's such a mega star that was like, do I add in our match? Like, what do I do here? But it was already so stacked. And then I was like, oh, maybe next year. And then, obviously, things started falling. But I think my main thing was when Crowley pulled out, I needed someone who matched the star power of Crowley. I needed a big name. And that's not me saying that someone else couldn't fit the slot, but there was no perfect person to replace Crowley Denali catch from the USA, coming over here with her massive bum, just straight up massive bum. But like, even at that, she's never wrestled in Scotland. This is Ali Catch's debut. Therefore, the opportunity was there. The spot was there. We needed a big star. A big star appeared. Here she is.
Yeah, name that. I've emailed her, just hoping, because, you know, Scottish debut, I'm going to have to find out more about this after she makes her debut. So hopefully, fingers crossed, fingers and toes, we'll get Ali Catch on in the future. So initially, you and Angel Hayes, of course, a very long history, came up together. You've wrestled together. You've wrestled against each other for years now. However many years, eight years or so?
Honestly.
If you take out the old pandemic time.
Yes.
So you came in thinking you were facing a tag team, a well-established mm-hmm. tag team, and now it's two individual wrestlers,
yes.
both of which have tag team experience, of course, Liam Slater with Johnny Moss and whoever, and many other tag team partners, and Ali Catch, of course, mm-hmm. with Effy. When it comes to like turning off your promoter hat, or taking off your promoter hat for a moment, put on your wrestler hat, does it make your approach to the match different from wrestling a tag team to two individuals as a team?
Yes, because the reason being is that Crowley and Alexis are an established tag team. People know that that is the team. Whereas Liam Slater is a very successful wrestler who's been about for a long, long time. And again, we've not saw Liam Slater in Scotland in how long now? So it's kind of like an opportunity was just kind of waiting at his front door, waiting for him to be picked up. And immediately, I remember having a conversation with Rory Coyle, and I was like, Liam Slater, why did I not think of that? So it was like, I had to bring him in. But I think it changes the match completely because obviously me and Angel, we're not really tag wrestlers. We've been in tag teams, but we're not tag wrestlers. But we also have our issues, and then we meet back up, and then we have issues, and then we meet back up. That's kind of our dysfunctional relationship. We're friends here. We hate each other here. So on. But then there's Ali Catch and Liam Slater, who are the mystery team, because they've not had any relation with each other. So my question is Liam Slater going to give in to the fishnets and the twerking and the grinding, or is Ali Catch going to become like Ivory, uncensored, where she's like, oh, straight edge, straight face, wearing a suit? We don't know.
And I suppose, in the dynamic as well, initially this may have been a bit more shenanigan filled, whereas mm-hmm. it may still be shenanigan filled, but yeah, it's not going to be a Falcon Crowley. You know, they like their shenanigans, and try to think of any other word than shenanigans, but that's the only word that's still sticking in my head because I love that word anyway.
Yes.
So it makes for an interesting night, and again, this is just one of many matches that's going to be, and it's £10. Like, that's if you're in the area, if you're in Glasgow, then it's a no-brainer to get to the show. I don't think there's any other shows running that day either in Glasgow, if I remember rightly. So I think
the reason is they'd be stupid to run that day in Scotland.
So if you're there for pre, I don't know, let the confidence fly. So if you're in Glasgow and celebrating Pride, then this is a show you need to get to. Just to celebrate not only yourself and your journey and being an ally or being part of the community or whatever it is, but you get to see not only these amazing local talents, but you get to see Ali Catch, like say, first time in Scotland, hasn't wrestled here before. Liam Slater, don't think if he's wrestled in Glasgow, it's been a long time. I think the last time he's wrestled in Scotland was Edinburgh tail end of last year. So that's a while ago in wrestling terms. So yeah, it'd be ridiculous not to go along to the show if you have any moment to spare. As far as match of the night, that's a ridiculous question to ask you probably because there's so many that there could be. But
Denise stresses her bosoms will be match of the night.
Fair enough. I was going to say, what's the dark horse? But I think we've we've hit the nail on that head there. Is will Denise survive with all of her clothes intact?
That's the poll.
That's it. That's the real tagline. Is I'm coming out. Will Denise?
It's part two.
I really like Debbie, so I hope she does. She takes that in the good spirit. I'm hoping it comes across. a phenomenal show that's lined up. For those that have listened to all this and have forgotten how to get tickets, you go to ringsideworld.co.uk. VIP entry 6:30 p.m. We get to see that fatal four way, and then doors open at 7:00. First bell 7:30 for an absolutely packed night at Slay Glasgow. 24 Glasford Street, if you want to know the address. If you've got a sat-nav, it's G11UL. Thank you for putting the whole address on your poster and times, because that seems to be happening less and less. It's really irritating me as someone who's tried to collate these things for calendars and stuff. But back to yourself a little bit before we round up and wrap up, because, like I say, it's been almost three years since we've had you on the podcast.
Yes.
You've ticked off a lot of amazing things, like say TNT World title, being a fixture in ICW. Even though it might not have be as grand as it was pre-pandemic, it's still got that recognizable name and branding. ICW Wrestling After Hours during Clash at the Castle weekend. Is there anything you've got left that you must tick off before? If your knee eventually goes, is there anything you want to just make sure you get in sooner rather than later?
I want to run with my TNT championship. That's number one. I want my world championship back, and I want to take it global. The main thing is I've started off this year, so I've got Finland coming up. I went to France. I went to America. So I've done the international. I've had a taste of it. I want more of it, and I want to be a defending champion. That's the main. I came here to fair fight. That's what I want to do, and I want, I think one of my favorite matches was with Ray Horace. Like, that was just another level, completely different to what I'd ever do. But it proved again, if I want to go to Mexico and put on a mask and be Lucha Libre, I could. So if I can take my TNT belt to Mexico, Japan, the thing is, I'm not ready to give up. So I hope my knee is not ready to give up, because I'm just getting started.
Fantastic. Mentioned US, of course. You're on that same show with a friend of mine for a long time, Keita Murray, who wrestled on that Big Gay Brunch Hate show.
Lovely.
A guy that I've known through Bebo. That's how long I've known Keita Murray for, show my age, if anything, is meeting someone through Bebo. Fantastic chat. There's so many things we could probably go into more detail, things like Mash of Scotty Rock, who's another name that's really bursting through this year. Things to Iron Girders, but everyone can go check out YouTube, go check out that match with Robbie X as well from Target recently. Is there anything you want to plug before we go our separate ways today?
No, I just want to thank everybody for supporting me. It's been a journey and a half. Right now, I am not 100%. I'm wrestling with a strained hamstring. But again, I'm not ready to give in. It's just the beginning, basically. If you want to see more of me, good, because you're getting more of me. And other than that, make sure you come to I'm Coming Out July 21st, Sunday, July 21st. Remember, your tickets also get you free entry to the Polo Lounge, which is just across the street from it, for an after party where you might bump into some of your favourite wrestlers. Thank you for having my boobs on the show as well as me. Other than that, thank you again. This has been great. And just remember, from your dad's browsing history, shame on you.